Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for the third installment in the NRF Retail Leadership Series, Candid Conversations with CEOs. I'm Matt Shea. I'm the President CEO of the National Retail Federation, and glad to be joining you again for a conversation this week with Chris Baldwin, the Executive Chairman of BJ's Wholesale Club and current board member of the NRF and our immediate past chairman. So Chris, thanks for being here. Really happy to have you joining us today.
Thanks, Matt. It's great to be with you.
As many of you know, Chris has been at BJ's since 2015 for 5 years as CEO of the company, and just in recent months has handed over to his successor, Lee Delaney, the current CEO, and Chris is now serving as executive chairman. And during his 5 years at BJ's, Chris had a terrific track record helping prepare the company to go public, investing in technology, innovation, the customer experience, a whole range of things to really improve overall operations. And prior to that, he's got 30 years of experience in the retail and consumer packaged goods and food industries. So Chris comes well prepared for this job and for whatever's next. But for today, we're happy to have Chris joining us to talk about both his time at BJ's, but also what he's seeing in the retail environment currently, the kinds of advancements we're going to see as we come out of the pandemic in terms of changed consumer behavior, and the future of the industry and where we go from here. So thank you again for joining us. And today's format is I'll ask Chris some questions. We'll have a conversation for about 30 minutes, and you'll be able to use the question and answer function to submit questions, and we'll get to those when we open it up for attendee participation. So we look forward to that. And so Chris, I guess as we start, you know, it's been a difficult past few days for our country. Retailers have been on the forefront of that. I know that you and I talked several times over the weekend, and both of us have had multiple conversations with other retail leaders and CEOs of companies. And so I just want to start by asking how you, your team, your stores are, and what kinds of things you've heard and been thinking about during the past few days.
Thanks, Matt. And let me start by saying I hope everybody on the call there, you and yours, are safe and well. Our country is hurting. Matt, we talked about this a couple times over the weekend, and our country is angry. As you know, I spent some time on the phone, as many of us did, talking to other retailers, and many of whom were CEOs. And I will tell you that universally, the leadership of our great industry stands united against discrimination and racism in all its forms. I think it's fair to say that when people feel they aren't heard, they speak more loudly. And our country is speaking to us. And we have too many people in our country who haven't been heard. And our industry, I believe, has a responsibility to be more inclusive, even more inclusive than we already have been. And we need to create an environment in which people get heard. And I look forward to being a part of that solution with you, Matt, and the rest of the NRF.
Well, thanks, Chris. And I think, as you said, number one, our hearts go out to the families, certainly of George Floyd and his family, but everyone that's been hurt by this, and the communities, and the retail industry, once again, is in the center of this, both as a gathering place and a place of employment, but creating so many opportunities, but also trying to serve all these communities, many of the communities that have been hardest hit. Mm-hmm. Have had retail operations right in their centers. And so as we move forward through this, and we want to continue those discussions too and renew our commitment to diversity and inclusion and all the initiatives in which we're involved with our members and directly through the NRF, you know, the events of the past week have really eclipsed the events of the past several months in terms of changing the nation's focus. But, you know, if we go back to early March, we were talking about a different crisis and a different challenge. And I remember in those early days, speaking with you and your team as we were going into the pandemic and beginning the conversation about the different regulations across different jurisdictions and who is going to be remaining open and who is going to be forced to close. Can you take us back to early and mid-March and talk a little bit about what that was like for you and Lee and the team as you tried to prepare the system? And maybe we should just start with talking about the numbers of stores and employees, just so everyone's got the right context of the magnitude of the challenge you were facing.
Sure. So BJ's Wholesale Club is an East Coast-based club store operator. We have 218 clubs from Maine to Miami, and 25% of our business is in the boroughs of New York. We also operate in places like Boston, Philadelphia, the big cities in North Carolina, down through Florida. And I think when we have the gift of time to look back at what happened here, most people in the United States will remember what they were doing on March 11th, 12th, and 13th when everything started to tip over as it relates to the COVID-19 pandemic. In particular, I think the day the NBA canceled their season, I think was March 13th. And I am really privileged to have led this company for quite a while, but and part of the joys of doing that is the ability to put together a great team. And I was succeeded on February 1st by Lee Delaney. And Lee had run our commercial operations for several years. And Lee, Bob Eddy, and I, who is our chief, Bob is our chief financial and administrative officer, have effectively led the company for the last 5 years. And all we've done is changed our roles on the team. And Lee became CEO on February 1st, and I became executive chairman. And it's interesting, on that day, we tried to rise to a different challenge, which was all about safety. Early in those days, I can remember speaking to you and many other retail CEOs about how we would try and operationalize things like PPE, because back then you weren't able to get very much of it. And in our situation, about 2/3 of the suppliers that were trying to sell us PPE were fraudulent. There was a lot of very unusual things going on. So we
dramatically, to say the least.
Yeah, we dramatically changed our sanitation protocols, more frequent cleanings of high touch areas, social distancing went into place. Team members were asked to wear protective equipment. We installed, remember when we couldn't get plexiglass to install sneeze guards across parts of the club we never could have considered. We limited capacity. There was a big debate for 3 or 4 days about what percentage of fire code capacity we would allow into our clubs. We introduced temperature checks. We asked people, probably the biggest cultural change, Matt, which was interesting, like so many other retailers, we have a bit of a hero's culture. In a hurricane, we stay open longer. We don't close until we absolutely have to. But so changing the culture from one in which, boy, I'm not feeling that well, I'm going to get to work because I need to serve our customers, that had to change right away. And that was a really hard thing for people to wrap their heads around because it's so ingrained in our company's culture for a long time. But, you know, as the pandemic continued, we regularly updated those protocols. We tried to stay in lockstep with the CDC and the NRF. But the biggest fundamental change is the first discussion we have every day now is about safety. How can we make sure we keep our people safe and our customers safe as well?
So, and you and I have had lots of conversations, and I've been able, we've got a store here in Falls Church, not far from where we live, that we've been to several times throughout the throughout the past couple of months, as we always are. And it has been remarkable, and I think is representative of the experience at many retailers that that the employees have really stepped up, the team members, the associates, the partners, have stepped up to serve those communities as we've been describing them as economic first responders, because they did stay open when many other businesses were forced to close. And they continue to serve those communities and those customers, which gave us all a lifeline to allow ourselves to maintain some level of normalcy in our lives. And that's given us a roadmap for things like the NRF's Operation Open Doors so that we can share those experiences with other businesses. How do you think as we move to this next phase, understanding that the events of the last week have been tragic and are going to create some setbacks in some communities from an operational perspective, but more broadly speaking, how have customers responded as they've gotten used to some changed requirements in terms of their own behavior and the social distancing and metering in stores. And, you know, and we went through the some shortages of some products in some places, and maybe you could talk about that a little bit, where we are now from your perspective. But how do you think consumers are behaving and starting to react now? How are we all handling the changes we've had to experience?
Sure. I think as with any situation like this, and I'm not sure we've seen anything just like this, but having led a company that was in the business of selling gasoline during Hurricane Sandy, I remember seeing that part of the Northeast U.S. in crisis, and we're certainly in that mode again now. The world is anxious, and people are anxious. So we've seen the best and worst of human behavior. Overall, I think people are really trying to do the right thing. Social distancing is not something people are used to. In my lifetime, I haven't dealt with many protein shortages, but the shortages we've had to deal with as retailers in chicken, beef, and pork have been challenging to deal with, because when you have an anxious consumer walking in, they can't find paper towels, they can't find bathroom tissue, and they can't find chicken. It can get very tricky very quickly. But I think overall, people have tried to be balanced with us. We have worked very hard to serve the communities. One thing I believe that is paramount as a retailer is two really important things. One is empathy, and two is kindness. Lee has led the team with a great deal of empathy, and it's important to understand that our team understands that as they're serving our members, those members are more anxious than they normally are on a Tuesday last October. And the way you can help people as they're anxious is just to simply be kind. And to the extent we can be kinder tomorrow than we are today, we'll be a better company for it.
Yeah, I think that's right. We've all been finding our own way through this.
Yeah.
And you don't know what everyone's situation is from day to day. And we've had some fabulous, and I would say on balance, far more fabulous experiences than not in the places of business that we've been able to support over the last couple of months. But people are edgier, and you see that. And you talk about the just because I know how well you know and understand the supply chain, and I find it just as an academic exercise interesting recognizing that from the perspective of the consumer, there was a lot of frustration because we've all been trained to be able to get whatever we want from any number of potential retailers whenever we want it, and frequently the next day, if not the same day, if not that minute. So can you talk about the supply chain just for a second? I know that's a little bit of a tangent, but you've got great insight into that and experience throughout your career. So talk about, you know, the supply chain bent, but it didn't break, So where do you think we are, and what do you think the things are that we've learned about this experience in terms of what happened with product shortages and the way the supply chain is structured?
Sure. I think the answer is different based on which part of our portfolio we're speaking about. And I don't think we've broken anything, but we pushed the food supply chain in particular about as hard as you can push it. As a practical matter, over the last 10 years, there's been a great deal of cost reduction in the both retail and consumer product supply chains around the world. And in this case, some of those supply chains got stretched to the point of almost breaking. You know, the paper business in the United States is not a terribly high margin business. So people who run paper businesses tend to operate them at very high levels of capacity. And when you have the intersection of high capacity utilization plus 40 and 50 and 60% spikes in demand, that math doesn't work. So in the short term, we certainly had our share of disruption as it related to paper supply, and it has started to somewhat get to some degree get better, but we're not out of the woods yet. Protein is another one where it is probably the epitome of a just-in-time supply chain. And when the wheels stop moving, and in this case, the couple of the plants in the Midwest that came offline it causes real disruption. We certainly felt that and we'll continue to feel that. And one of the tricky parts as we look to serve consumers is that has flowed through, you know, in this world of supply and demand, when demand is way up and supply is way down, what happens is prices go up. So you're starting to see consumer price indices pop to a larger degree than they have in a long time. That is somewhat offset in the United States by gasoline prices being at historic lows. One of the things that worries me is the impact on the average American consumer that some of these supply shortages have created in terms of pricing.
Yeah. So in terms of, since you mentioned the consumer is at the heart of all of this, and that changed behaviors maybe are going to stay with us in some ways. Some of the things that have been different about the past few months, whether it's fulfillment options and delivery or curbside pickup or any of those, what kinds of things did you need to adopt in that regard that were enhanced from your normal operations or your pre-pandemic operations? And what kinds of things do you think will persist or sustain as the economy moves back into a broader reopening and a phase of true recovery?
Sure. You mentioned earlier that I've been at BJ's for 5 years, and since I started, we've been working on developing a set of capabilities. Bob, Lee, and I have been, and those capabilities that we've invested substantially in before our IPO, after our IPO, really 5 years of work paid off in 90 days. You know, at a human level, it was probably the most humbling 90 days of my career. A lot of people work really hard, and we spoke about that, to try and serve our communities. And in our company, as in so many other retailers, we consider it a privilege to serve them. But the world changed on March 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th. I think we had three separate company record days. We've talked publicly about this in the month of March, and we had them almost in succession. And the previous record was shattered by about 30%. And you had a couple of things going on all at the same time. Obviously, our traffic went through the roof. Basket size went way up as people looked to stock up. And they use different services. We have invested substantially in digital capabilities, from same-day delivery to curbside pickup and buy online pickup in club, all of which exploded. We re-reported, I guess it was last week sometime, maybe 2 weeks ago, but our online business more than tripled, and our delivery business grew by eightfold in the quarter. And thank goodness we had done the work over the last 5 years to try and build those capabilities, but our team responded with extraordinary effort to deliver to our members. But the biggest change is how people interact with us digitally. You know, every CEO you've ever talked to speaks about trying to be available to their members or their customers on the terms of their choosing. That's so easy to say. And it's a bit of a throwaway line, but between March 12th and today, we have, that has become real. And you've heard many CEOs say, their omni business expanded in five years worth of time in about 90 days. And the environment was a little crazed, but I think the biggest change is how people engage with it. We'll continue to try and serve them if that's the way they choose to do business with us.
Yeah. So Chris, on that point, so those investments made over the last number of years all really paid off in a very short period of time, just because of the external environment and the demand side. And a lot of that in the technology side, I mean, there has to be some dimension of enhanced data capabilities, maybe some artificial intelligence. I mean, the analytics that you're using, all of which I think delivers an enhanced customer experience, right? It should all be better. It creates more opportunities, and the efficiencies increase and satisfaction goes up. What about at the team level? You talked a minute ago about the team. So in an environment like that, do you think about a team needing different set of skills than historically, as the consumer environment changed so much that as you and Lee look at the future of the company that that you think, you know, smart leaders should be thinking differently about the kinds of skill sets and talents they need of the people that that they're working with and that are helping make the success of the company real?
Sure. I would consider a couple of things. And some of them are hard skills, some of them are soft skills. I think on the hard skills, the technology team that we've built over the last 5 years is terrific, and they've done really extraordinary work, and I'm proud of them. We've continued to enhance our operational capabilities, so we run better clubs than we used to, and many, many companies could claim the same thing. Our marketing insights team is continuing to grow and develop because we have to figure out a way to serve each member we have uniquely. And the other side of this is the soft skills. I get asked all the time, Matt, after having been a CEO a couple of times for about 10 years, and what are the skills that you think people don't get that are required to be a successful CEO? And I think it's empathy is 1, 2, and 3. So on the soft side, if you think about the world we're going to be entering post-pandemic, empathy needs to be a skill that gets elevated in the minds of every board member and every executive out there. Just think about the challenges we're going to have when we allow people come back to work in an office setting. I don't think that's going to be anytime soon for a lot of our companies. But how do you deal with the person who has a sick child and can't come into work that day and they want to work at home? Empathy will be required. How will you deal with an older customer who can't get all the technology quite right? Empathy will be required. So I think the combination of the hard skills and technology, operations, finance that have gotten built in our company over the last 40 years since the company's inception is one thing. But I think empathy will be of paramount importance as we get into the world of the future.
And Kristen, in that environment, both the most recent, 12 weeks, but also going forward, it seems that the marketing, the conversations with customers, not just in person primarily in the stores, but just the marketing efforts, the way you talk to all of your club members, had to evolve pretty substantially. I mean, how do you think at a time like this, I mean, you're trying to convey empathy and presumably you want to reassure them as to the safety protocols and procedures in stores. And as you said a little bit ago, meeting them where they are. How has the marketing piece of this changed and evolved over the last several months?
Yeah, I think that the premium on being genuine has gone through the roof. Yeah. Let's start there. It's interesting how many of us would have, it's about 1,000 people on the call, and how many of us would have forecasted 6 months ago that in May of 2020 or June of 2020, I guess it's June 1st now, we'd be talking about a primary marketing message being safety.
Right.
Brian Cornell has been public about the fact they're trying to make Target the safest place in America to shop. We're certainly working on that at BJ's. And it's interesting how what you used to think of as weaknesses could be now strengths in the safety-driven universe. We have very big stores with very wide aisles. 6 months ago, that wasn't that cool. And now it's a big store with big aisles that people can walk down 6 feet apart. Yeah. Is really important. And how do we want to talk about that? How do you want to make people comfortable? But I think overall in retail, the challenge is how do we make people feel safe in a world where we were trying to sell a value-oriented proposition like a club store or a beauty proposition, whether you're Ulta or Sephora or a department store, how do you make people come into your store and feel safe? It's easier said than done, but it's the primary marketing challenge of the future, in my view.
Yeah, I think that's right. It's the challenge, and it's also the opportunity, isn't it? To the point
sure
that
is.
You made a minute ago, that those brands that are able to effectively communicate their commitment, not just in a visible way, but everything that's sort of below the waterline, the 90% of the iceberg that you don't see, that people really believe, this is a safe, they care about me. They are concerned about my safety, that of my family, that of their employees. I think those are the winners, right? Those are the companies that will take share and will win in this kind of an environment.
There's no doubt, Matt. And, you know, I keep talking about it, but empathy. If you can have an employee base that's empathetic towards their customers, customers will feel more safe. And figuring out how to unlock that is really important for all of us in our industry. And in a world that's anxious, empathy will come to the top.
So, Chris, I've heard you say, you know, many times as I've learned from you about how you think about your business and other retail businesses, you've talked about BJ's, your emphasis on convenience and fresh, especially the emphasis on fresh, that's a competitive advantage, that you've invested a lot there in the produce, the fresh foods, the grocery piece, and the assortment more broadly. But so with all the changes that took place over the last few months in online, for example, it seems that one of the things that has not been unlocked yet is how to do fresh online at scale. That seems to be something that everyone has, you know, whether it's Amazon and Whole Foods or, you know, every grocer, and everyone's gotten better at it. Walmart's very, very good at it now. Target's good. You're very good there. You know, Costco, Kroger, you know, Southeast grocers, we could go on. So what do you think happens to online? So obviously there's been a big spike in online over the past few months of necessity, but how are you thinking about the future? When we go back to normal, will we all sort of revert back to, we like to go to the store for fresh, or do you think some of this will be a permanent ratcheting up of the, or how much will be a permanent ratcheting up of new online behavior? People are talking about online behavior could be 25 or 30% of all retail sales in 5 years, when last year it was only about 11%. Where are you on that? What do you think is a realistic assessment of where we're headed?
Yeah, I think we probably jumped forward 5 years in every dimension of online purchasing habits. And as I told you, our same day delivery business grew by eightfold in the quarter. And it has, as we said in our earnings call, it hasn't slowed down. And for us, that's good. I think ultimately, there's a variety of intersecting dynamics going on with the U.S. consumer now. And I think you're going to, for the foreseeable future, have this issue with people not wanting to make trips to the store that they don't have to. And for us, we sell large packages of products at really good prices. And when you can deliver that to the doorstep, that is something we will continue to drive. We have a partnership with Instacart that we believe is productive for them and is certainly productive for us. So the economic structure of the business is advantaged in our view. And the other thing that I see from a consumer behavior perspective is a significant barrier to trial in same day delivery is the simple thought of, will I be home to accept the delivery? If I want to buy a book and have it delivered to my house, I really don't care if it's sitting on my porch for 3 hours or 2 days. If I have a gallon of milk and a pound of cheese, I care a lot. And in the world, in the post-pandemic world, I believe you're going to see a structural change in how people work. And the one of the barriers to trial we always saw is, especially with dual working families, with both is working, it's a terrific opportunity for us to drive delivery, because somebody is usually home now. And 6 months ago, that wasn't the case. So it's been a big barrier to trial. So trial has gone through the roof, and the depth of the trial is really high because the repeat rates are very, very high. So I think a lot of the online behavior has changed to some degree permanently. And I think that doesn't change until there's a vaccine or some sort of a therapeutic that gets people through this if they happen to get it.
Yeah. Well, maybe we could jump back, and I'll just reiterate, we've got a number of questions in the queue and I'm trying to work through them. But if you've got a question for Chris, and if you see me look down, I'm trying to read them as they come in. So it's not that I'm not interested in what we're talking about. But I guess, Chris, let me just ask two questions related to you mentioned empathy, and you've talked a lot about the team. And so first on the empathy question, someone asked, you know, what kinds of things do you do to drive that through the organization? If you and Lee are, and now Lee is sort of leading on being empathetic and helping everyone understand that, you know, we want to relate to all of our club members and support them when they're in the stores. Are there some examples of things that you can talk about that, how do you bring that to life at a company with your kind of scale and your customer count and your club members and that sort of thing?
Sure. I think the best thing leaders can do is model what they want to see in their organization. And Lee and Bob and I have all tried to model empathy and how we operate. You know, we do a daily call with the executive team. It's always a it starts with a discussion of safety. Making sure everybody on the team understands the paramount importance we all put on safety is a critical part of leading through this environment. The other thing to do, I think company cultures are modeled by what they celebrate. I've certainly worked for companies in the past that celebrate cost cuts, cost savings, and we're trying to celebrate people who are empathetic to our customers and people who are just simply kind. And if you, as we continue to grind on this issue, I think we'll become a better company for it. Because I do believe in a world where people are anxious, if you can contribute to making somebody's day a little bit better, our business is going to be just fine. And that's very different than where we were just six short months ago. I'd like to think we were a kind company going into this, but if Lee has anything to do with it, if Bob Eddy has anything to do with it, or if I have anything to do with it, we'll be kinder and more empathetic coming out of it.
Yeah, yeah, that's great, great insight. And in terms of the team members, all of your associates across the stores, how have you supported them? You mentioned, you know, sort of the hero mentality of, you know, we're the guys that are, you know, out there when no one else is. That has to have taken certainly a physical toll and some of your members, some of your team members, and also emotional tolls. How have you been able to support those thousands of employees across the system over the last several months?
Sure. The most important thing is making sure they believe we're there for them, and we're running this company to try and support them, not the other way around. But we've been very aggressive on compensation. In late March, we started with an incremental $2 an hour in pay that continues to today. And for all our hourly associates, we've done a multiple rounds of manager bonuses. I think in the first quarter, we spent over $50 million on employee compensation incremental to what we would extraordinarily historically have done. That's plus or minus, you know, it's a very large percentage of the gross margin dollars that we earned in the quarter from selling what we sell. Those kind of things will continue for a while because the work that people are doing is extremely important, and we want to make sure they're paid properly. We've also done things like eliminated our absenteeism policy. We've expanded sick leave. We've done all the things necessary to try and make sure that people felt secure in their job, point number one. We have made sure that if they don't feel well, they are incented to stay home, which is completely opposite of our culture of a few months ago. And then we're continuing to invest in rewarding them appropriately for the incredible job they're doing every day.
So, and I encourage people to keep sending in questions. And I got a lot of good ones here from folks and want to go to one. So that takes us a little bit off the topic of the past couple of months, but goes back to something, Chris, you said at the beginning, which was the journey of taking the company public.
Sure.
In the summer of 2018. And it was right in the middle of your tour of duty as chairman of the NRF board,
right.
which we're grateful that right in the middle of that, you had this little project called Taking Your Company Public. So can you talk a little bit, and you and I obviously, you know, we discussed what we could discuss back then. Obviously, there were some things we couldn't talk, you couldn't talk about, and we didn't. But just as you led up to that, the company you referenced had been public before, was taken private. You really were brought into for this purpose of helping get the company in shape to go public. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about what that was like? Just share a few insights and perspectives of that journey, the several years leading up to it, in sort of the way you prioritized the things that needed to happen in 2015, 16, 17, and the way you built the team, the way you engaged your stakeholders. You had private equity investor owners and other stakeholders. So how did you bring everyone together, and how did you get aligned on priorities about what was going to happen, hopefully in the summer of 2018?
Sure. It was, looking back on it, it was probably one of the, from a business perspective, one of the singular privileges of my career. And all too often, private equity gets a bad rap as it relates to retail. And in some cases, private equity deserves that rap. In this case, they don't. Frankly, private equity ownership was a necessary part of, in my view, the resurgence of our company. In the course of the time we were private, we had to invest substantially in the foundational capabilities for us to be a successful modern day retailer. Whether it's hundreds of millions of dollars to put in SAP, the ability the private equity ownership gave me to recruit new talent, put people in new jobs, create a better organization that so many other retailers have done. We built new inventory systems. We built new marketing systems. We built new membership systems. And as a result of that, over the course of 5 years, we flipped a negative growth company to a positive growth company and grew earnings by about 50%. And in the first quarter of this year, Lee and team, once I got it out of the way, they really drove sales, and we put up a 27 comp in the first quarter. And as I said earlier, more than tripled our online business, had an eightfold growth in our delivery business. And so the process of taking the company public was just a change in the capital structure of the company. But more important, we have started the process of letting the company realize its full potential. Private equity was a big part of that, because they were incredibly supportive. Both our owners, CVC and Leonard Green and Partners, were incredibly supportive of making the investments necessary in order to be a competitive retail company in the future. And the step towards going public was, you know, at its simplest terms, just a change in the capital structure that will continue to be a part of our future for the whole future. And Lee and team will do great work, continue to make the choices necessary to be competitive. But our business is healthy, vibrant, and growing. And we do something consumers want, and we expect to continue to do it. And the process of taking the company public was a fascinating experience, because back then, big box retail wasn't that fun. And there were more bad examples than good examples. And the number of times we had to answer questions about, would this retailer get you, or will that retailer get you, in terms of competitive situations, I think we've proven ourselves to be right. And the company is, as I said, healthy, vibrant, and growing. And it's an exciting time to be in retail.
Yeah, no, it's certainly is for lots of reasons. I remember that summer and the things leading up to it, and it's been exciting to see the journey and the transformation of the business and the, you know, the relevance of the business and the growth. It's just been really remarkable. And I think, as you said, at a you know, notwithstanding the pandemic, which was, you know, sort of an external event that couldn't have been really predicted and couldn't have been avoided, maybe. But you know, when you said at one of your speeches at the NRF annual convention that retail isn't back because it never went anywhere, it was never gone. And it is an exciting time, and in part because of all the accelerated innovation that's taken place the past few months. As you said, you know, years of growth occurred just in a period of weeks. As you think about the future for BJ's and for other retailers, what kinds of, you know, in terms of new investments in technologies, do you think this will continue in inventory and supply chain efficiencies or in fulfillment, or we haven't even talked about payments. Now we're in a world with behind plexiglass and no one wants to touch, you know, the point of sale keypads. Everybody wants to go touchless. If you're in a store environment, of course. Are there a couple of things that you and Lee and Bob talk about when you think about making investments over the next period of several years? Where would you be looking, or what kinds of things do you think smart retail executives are thinking about right now?
Sure. I think over time in this industry, as with others, those that are willing to and able to invest smartly into the future will separate themselves from everybody else in their industry. I think that this pandemic has probably tilted a little bit the nature of what people will invest in. But the primary driver of success will be your ability and smarts as it relates to, can you invest? And then what do you invest in? I think that the everything digital will continue to be a use of investment related funds, whether it's same day delivery, in our case, improving our ability to do that in fresh, because there is no CEO who would come on a discussion like this with you, Matt, and be arrogant enough to say we have it all figured out. We don't. But we're going to continue to work on it, and the continued grind will yield better outcomes in the future. I think the technology associated, everything being digitized and personalized, you know, we have the privilege of having more than 5.5 million members, and over, you know, 3, 4, or 5 years ago, we used to send the same marketing material to every one of those members. And not in the not too distant future, every one of those members will have personalized marketing. And we're well along that path. So the investment necessary to actually do that effectively has been substantial, but you have to do it to be as successful as we want to be. I also think that the world of safety will be another source of investment. You know, whether it's how we do transactions. I think, you know, 10 years from now, my kids will look at cash registers the way you and I look at phone booths.
Yeah.
Remember when you used to plug 14 quarters in there to go check voicemail? And they'll look at a cash register that way. So I think you'll see an acceleration in no touch checkout, in everything that it can, to limit the human interaction in a retail setting.
Yeah, I think that's right. And that continues to be a place where there's a lot of opportunity for growth and both the digital side for remote payments, but also the in-person payment system, and how much transformation has already taken place, but how much more. I think that's a place where that friction at checkout that everyone talks about, that's how do we take friction out of the transaction? And that's one of those places. So I'm sure there's more innovation there yet to come. One of the things I know that during your time at NRF and even before that in your own career, you've been very committed to creating opportunities for people, whether at NRF through our student programs and through the foundation or some of the other charitable work that you've been involved in, in other parts of your life. Maybe you could talk for a minute about your view of the retail industry as an employment opportunity, as a job creator, as an engine of economic opportunity. Any perspectives on how you see that as we work through the pandemic at a time like this with the kind of social challenges that we face? Are you optimistic, pessimistic, realistic? Where would you be on the role retail can play in addressing some of those issues?
Yeah, I'm probably realistic in the short term and very optimistic in the longer term. And here, the framework for the way I think about this is actually really simple. And so many other CEOs who I've gotten a chance to get to know through NRF would say exactly what I'm about to say, in that it is a privilege to serve, and the responsibility that goes along with getting one of these jobs is significant, in that you have a responsibility to bring people up. In our country, there are about 140 million jobs, about 30 million of them ish are in the retail and restaurant sectors. And I consider it a privilege and also a responsibility to make sure we're bringing people along. So many other companies like Walmart, Darden, Target, Costco, all great companies who have worked really hard to create great opportunity for people. I think we have a responsibility to keep that going. And in the short term, it's going to be challenging for some retail companies to do that. But in the longer term, I believe that, you know, as an industry that represents, 25-ish% of the jobs in the United States, I think we have a responsibility to do that. As you mentioned, I spend most of my time outside of work on inner city education and trying to break the cycle of a generational poverty through education. And I do that through a lot of means, but it all links to this thought of I think we all have a responsibility to bring people through and bring people up. And when you can get about 6 months ago, I have 69 of our 215 general managers at BJ's Wholesale Club. So almost a third of them had started it out as hourly employees. And the general manager job in our company is the most important job in our company. It's certainly not the CEO. When you have a situation where somebody started pushing carts or cleaning the floors, who ended up running a big building for us with a big supply chain, hundreds of people, that is a breakthrough in economic change for those families that person is a part of. And we have a responsibility to keep that going.
Yeah. No, that's a great insight. And that is one of the wonderful things about the retail industry, is in many ways it is a real meritocracy. I mean, you can rise up through the industry, and there are lots of stories like that of CEOs and senior executives and store managers that started out bagging groceries or one of the entry level positions. And so there is great opportunity for growth. Well, that lifting people up and creating jobs is a great segue to this next question from one of our participants here, who simply wants to know, when is BJ's going to expand into the Midwest and the West Coast and create more jobs?
Stay tuned. When we announce that, it certainly won't be in a conversation with 1,000 people on the line.
I thought maybe.
Look, Lee and the team have done a really nice job of expanding. We've opened in Michigan in the last couple of months, and the clubs have been very, very successful. We're really encouraged by that, and there's more to come. So the club store business in the United States works. The value retail business in the United States works. We look forward to bringing what we do to more customers over time.
Yeah, that's well, and maybe on a more
that was my only CEO talking point I used today. That was like, yeah, blah, blah, that's blah, good. Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah. The rest has all been unscripted and unprompted.
It has been.
It does on a sort of a related note. So retail and real estate, and you and I have had this conversation, and you and I. You know, they asked us when we were on Squawk Box together on CNBC a couple of years ago. I mean, how many times have we done media and press on this the last couple of years? Well, you know, stores are closing. Stores are dying. You know, there's too much real estate. And you've thought a lot about this and spoken a lot about this, about the issue of real estate and retail. And maybe you could share your views on the state of the industry relative to the real estate devoted to retail, both currently and what you think about the future, not specific to BJ's opening stores in new locations.
Look, I think that communities around the country will need to, there will likely be less retail square footage over time. But I think there's also going to be just an alteration in how retail square footage changes. BNC, A malls are doing quite well. Ask somebody from Saks or Macy's, ask Jeff about that. And A malls are doing quite well. BNC malls, not so well. Our clubs continue to do very, very well. We're going to be a net acquirer of real estate versus the other way. And I think you're going to see this ongoing transformation in the retail square footage that's out there. And I think it's probably too early to tell on the post-pandemic impact. And it'll be very interesting to see how rent payments go for non-essential retailers over the next couple of months to see what kind of real estate footprints might change. But I think it's a bit too early to tell in the short term.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think on balance, certainly that it doesn't seem sustainable in terms of the changed behavior in consumer activities and the amount of real estate devoted to retail in this country. It's somewhat out of balance, and mm-hmm. over time it'll get into balance. But
I think Matt, we talked about the United States has about 22, 23 square foot per capita. And right. most of the rest of the developed world has about 5 or 6 square feet per capita. Right. And places like Germany, it's about 2. So there is no question the world of retail through the real estate booms in the early part of the century probably overdid it a little bit. And there'll be a correction, and it'll be a real planning challenge for some of the communities we serve to deal with that change. But I continue to believe there's a future there. And post-pandemic, it'll be interesting to see how that all plays out.
Yeah, I agree. We have a lot of questions in the queue still remaining. We're getting close to being at 1 hour, but I guess I did want to ask you sort of as we got close to the end, and you talked about the characteristics of successful leaders, particularly at a time like this, and the need to be empathetic and to listen and to model behavior. But as we look forward to the next, we've been through the period of survival, and in March and April and May, we sort of have survived. And now we're getting into the sustaining phase of how do we, work our way through this until, as you said, we get a vaccine or we get some enhanced treatment procedures and things like that. So as you look forward to the next phase, which will be how you succeed in the changed environment, whatever that means, any final thoughts or observations or comments on the way the framework you use to evaluate opportunities or think about the challenges or just do some modeling of what you believe the future is going to bring?
Yeah. I'm not sure I know enough yet. We're doing a lot of consumer work on this subject to understand it more deeply. But I think that one of the primary changes that will change consumer behavior is less about retail and more about the workplace. As you think about the interaction between how people work and how people shop, those two things are highly connected. As an example, I mentioned earlier, Matt, that one of the barriers to trial and home delivery was right. I won't be home to accept the milk and cheese. Right. Now they will be. So I think that the changes to the American workplace will be substantial. It's not clear to me how anybody is going to anywhere near the number of people who work in very large towers in places like New York will ever go back to those places, because it could take you an hour to get to the 50th floor if we do 2 or 3 people on an elevator at a time. So now I think all that changes with a vaccine. So that's why I say we'll see. But I think that in this case, we're likely to see some permanent changes and much more focused on the home. Our general merchandise business, as an example, has really boomed because of, people are doing things in their home they never used to do before. And we actually, if anybody has any trampolines they could sell us, we'll buy them. We can't keep trampolines in stock. We'll see how it all plays out in the coming months. But, I'll make my final comment by saying I hope everybody continues to be safe and well, and think about as you lead your companies, how you can be a little bit kinder, a little bit more empathetic, because I think we'll all be better for it, both as business people and as citizens.
Perfect. No, that's terrific. Chris, thanks. And thanks everyone for joining us for this conversation with the executive chairman of BJ's Wholesale Club, Chris Baldwin. Chris, thank you for joining us. Thank everyone for being part of this today in our third Retail Leadership Series conversation. Our next conversation will take place next Thursday, June 11th, with Hal Lawton, the president and CEO of Tractor Supply Company. So we look forward to having this discussion with Hal and talking about the Tractor Supply journey when we meet next week. But thank you all for joining us. Chris, thanks again very much for being part of this, and best to you and your team. Look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Matt, for having me. Be well.
Okay. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.